serving Essex, Kent, and Lambton counties. This is CBC Television, Windsor 9.
The following is a live presentation of CBC Sports.
What began as a trophy for Canada's rugby championship way back in 1909 has evolved into a symbol of football tradition, reflecting memories of the championship athletes who have produced with a national title on the line. Yes, it's the Grey Cup, awarded once each year to the CFL's best. From a southern football hotbed where champions once roamed comes an upstart with no CFL tradition. It's a team of hired guns and mercenaries, problem players and game breakers, all-stars and outlaws. It's coached by a mentor with impressive CFL credentials, once the golden boy, a leader in this very city. Now the home side is coached by a father figure, a quiet-spoken man who stays out of the limelight. But he must handle his own unruly band. They take no prisoners, they bend the rules. Their talented quarterbacking duo is beset with injuries, on the limp and racked with pain as the big game approaches. Grey Cup tradition, though, means it's time to have some fun. These fellas want to spoil the party. Today, live from Vancouver, the 82nd Grey Cup weekend is here. It's Baltimore and the BC Lions on CBC. Well, it rained this morning, as you can see, a gray Saturday afternoon, just after 2 o'clock. We look live. No rain, though, at BC Play Stadium from the outside. As we shift and come inside, our cameras will now zoom in to our host location. I was first here in 1983, and I'll tell you what, this atmosphere reminds me of 1983, with the excitement when the BC Lions were home to the Toronto Argonauts, Obilovich and the Argonauts defeating Don Matthews and the British Columbia Lions. It's a very different atmosphere from when we were last here. That, of course, was 1990. This place was like a morgue. Winnipeg hammering the Edmonton Eskimos. There were something like 20,000 empty seats. Anyhow, there is a lot more excitement, a different atmosphere for football in 1994. And as we kick off our 1994 Grey Cup weekend, let's show you the menu for this afternoon's show. Folks, in spite of what the league will tell you, expansion has not been a success except for Baltimore. We'll look at their success. Paul Beeston, a Canadian, he's president of the Argonauts. We'll talk about Canadian quotas. And we'll take a look at the Lion Kings as they are roaring for the third time at home. Good afternoon, I'm Brian Williams. Welcome to Vancouver and our coverage of the 1994 Grey Cup weekend. Folks, I talked about 1983. Before going down to Marke Lee on the field, let me show you a bit of videotape from this building in 1983, and listen carefully. Crazy George live 11 years later. I got to tell you a great story, though. Baltimore officials this morning apparently complained about Crazy George calling him, and I quote, an artificial stimulant, saying he should be banned here from the game tomorrow. He will be here in force tomorrow. Let's get out of the field. Behind me, Marke Lee is standing by. Marke, I talked about the noise. Matthews liked it in 1983. He is singing a different song in 1994.
That's right, Brian. The tables are turned this time around, but there's been another development with respect to the crowd noise. The CFL ruling today that the fanometer, that scoreboard device they use here to whip the crowds into a frenzy, may only be used during commercial breaks and timeouts, not when Baltimore is on the field. Baltimore, nevertheless, has come prepared for the deafening roar of that partisan crowd here at BC Place. The offensive linemen, the running backs, and the quarterbacks have all been fitted with custom-made earplugs. And earlier today, just before, as practice ended for Baltimore, offensive guard Guy Earl displayed the device for us.
This is an ear device that the offense line and running backs were fitted for this on Wednesday night. And what it is, it filters out the loud noise crowd, and it helps us hear the quarterback a little easier. You put it in, you put a little grease on the tip, you face it towards your eyes, and you just kind of roll it up, sort of like that, and it kind of fits in just like that. And it's no problem coming out. We tried it yesterday with the helmet, and it won't have no problem falling out. You just take it out the same way, and hopefully we won't need it too much tomorrow.
As a last resort, Baltimore will go to a silent no-huddle offense. The center will snap the ball without a verbal command from quarterback Tracy Ham. He will be using a wristband such as this. The plays have been coded and numbered, and Ham will call the plays using numbers, using his fingers, two or three, to call the plays to the players without having to shout them throughout the deafening noise here at BC Place. So communications becomes a big, big problem for Baltimore in tomorrow's Grey Cup. For a BC perspective now, let's go across the field and join Steve Armitage.
Mark, there's one member of the BC Lions who isn't going to be really thinking of noise tomorrow against the Baltimore CFLers, and that player is Darren Flutie. Flutie and his wife Terry are expecting the birth of their first child tomorrow. So what's the problem, you say? Darren Flutie is here. Well, his wife happens to be in Franklin, Massachusetts. Now, Flutie has made a pact with his wife that when she goes into labor to deliver the child, he will be with her. He intends to stick to that pact, even if she goes into labor tomorrow morning, which of course would mean that Darren Flutie would miss the 1994 CFL championship game. Now, he does this. He will leave the team if she goes into labor with the blessing of his head coach, Dave Ritchie. I talked to the Lions owner, Bill Carmi, just a few moments ago, and I said, what do you think of all this, Bill? And Bill said, it's a family matter, and family matter takes priority over football. One footnote, do you think if the baby's born in the next 24 hours, they will call it Earl, as in Gray?
All right, Steve, you talked about families. This is Football Fest 94, Family Day here at BC Place Stadium. Both teams have already practiced. Baltimore earlier this morning, the Lions finished about 35 minutes ago. Speaking of the floor of the stadium, right now, let's go down to the floor of the stadium near the 50-yard line. We say good afternoon to Scott Oake and his very special game day guest. Scott.
All right, Brian. Well, Bomber quarterback Matt Dunigan has two Grey Cup rings, won one of them in this building back in 1987. Ron Lancaster's head coach of the Edmonton Eskimos, whose reign as Grey Cup champions lasts slightly more now than 24 hours. Let's deal with the issues raised by Mark and Steve. Matt, first of all, you got your noise, you got your wristbands, you got your fanometers, you got signals, you got all of that, but might the best strategy in this building tomorrow, with maybe as many as 60,000 fans in it, be to score first?
Without question. Now, although Baltimore is the home team, they're in enemy territory. He'd like to try to take the other team out of the game, or the crowd out of the game, but it's going to be difficult because the Premier has said that beer is allowed in the stands, and these fans may not know the difference of who scores first and who doesn't.
Let me say that where I come from, there's a direct relationship between beer and noise, too. So you might be onto something there, Matt.
Thank you.
Ron, I know, as a member of my father's generation, you have trouble with the notion that Darren Flutie might go home tomorrow to be with his wife if she goes into labor. If you're Dave Ritchie, are you going to bed tonight praying that Terry Flutie's water does not break before game time tomorrow?
Yeah, if you're Dave Ritchie, you do. But if it happens, hey, that's life. You go play with what you got. I know your father's generation, Scott, says simple. If you have a job, you do it. And my wife would want me here playing football. And but as you say, it's a family matter. But hey, you can't worry about that. We're going to play the game anyway.
All right. Thank you both. And it's good to have you with us as game day analysts. And we'll also, of course, have the pleasure of your company throughout game coverage tomorrow. Brian, back to you.
All right, Scott, our game analysts are, of course, Dan Kepley and James Curry. We've talked about noise for the offensive players. What about you defensive people? The noise has to affect the defensive team, which will be the home team in this case.
Well, I think it really incites the defense even more because it puts you at a level where you have to play intense football. And you know as a defensive player that you can go out there and take the crowd out of it with a couple of tremendous hits.
I mean, it does. It's the kind of thing, and the defense has just an integral kind of audibilization system the same way the offense does. So it's important that they make their calls according to the formations they see, and it gets to be just a pure point of communication again, Brian. It has to be related down from outside linebacker to halfback. Halfbacks has to make sure that the corners know what they're hearing, and everybody has to be on the same page.
I like what Ronnie Lancaster said earlier. You know, they've had so many empty seats in the past. This place is full. They should be excited. They should be happy with this intensity.
Well, I think football here in Canada is like football anywhere in North America. Fans in the CFL CFL deserve to come out and see the best show possible, and that's what they're going to get. I mean, I was on that 83 team that came in here and beats the BC Lions here at home, and it was a great feeling to come in here and do that in front of that full house, and we're going to get that same type of excitement once again here in 94.
These teams have had enough time through the course of the 94 season of playing below average kind of crowds, so I guess they've got to be excited. It's football. You go out there, and as soon as that opening kickoff takes place, Brian, it becomes just 60 minutes, and get the job done, and you can win the Grey Cup.
It is indeed refreshing to see a full house and lots of noise as we go to commercial on this Saturday afternoon. Speaking of noise, let me tell you, the Baltimore fans have arrived in B.C.
C-O-L-T-S, Grey Cup, going back to the U.S. of A.
We're here! Go!
Place Stadium in Vancouver as Football Fest Family Day 94 continues. A couple of our production workers down in the field having a good time this afternoon. Paul Beeston, the president of the Toronto Argonauts, and that is not Paul Beeston, but he is sitting here and he will join us in just a few minutes. A Canadian that succeeded in an American game. He will talk about quotas. Now, in spite of what the CFL will tell you, expansion has not been a success except in Baltimore. Here is part one of Blueprint for Success.
A decade ago, in the dead of the night, a disenchanted owner takes the Colts from Baltimore, moves to Indianapolis. A storied franchise gone. Only the memories remained of a glorious past. Names etched in American football folklore. Bubba Smith, terrorized quarterbacks. The great Johnny Unitas, the consummate quarterback. Legend brought back to associate tradition with Baltimore's new Canadian brand of football.
I think what we were able to do here in this town was our football team has united a city back together again, in a sense, because a lot of people have a reason now to come out to Memorial Stadium, cheer for a football team, and certainly there's 40 years of memories at Memorial Stadium, and now today they have their own stars. Those names turned into Mike Pringle and Tracy Hamm and Michael Brooks and O.J. Bergantz, and we brought football back, and they wanted football, and the fact that we took the initiative day one and named the team the Baltimore CFL Colts, that really got their interest, because that's something they used to come to Memorial Stadium, tailgate, go to the game, sit in the same seats, be with those people every Sunday. They used to come here together, and all of a sudden, for 10 years, that disappeared.
They couldn't call them the Colts, and that only galvanized the fans. Institutions like the Big Wheel rallied behind the CFLers.
Back in 1975, when the NFL Colts were here, so it was a Sunday afternoon, nothing was happening, and I said, I gotta get this crowd awake. So I got up, started doing cheers with my body. We got the crowd up. From that day, we never lost, the NFL Colts never lost a game the rest of that season.
Memorial Stadium sat empty, but the Colt marching band held a 10-year vigil, playing bowl games, waiting for football to come back.
When the father's sitting on the sideline and watching us march on a football field or watching us march during a parade, they sort of get misty-eyed and say, I remember when, I remember when. Then they want it for their generation. And that's why, like I said, when the CFL came back here, they're coming into not only the old generation, but a new generation. And the CFL will fly here at all events.
We grew up in here in Baltimore, and these fans grew up under the John Unitas era. And we were a throwing ball club. And if I wasn't a good receiver coming out of that backfield, I wouldn't have lasted 12 years in this league. And especially with this team with Unitas throwing the ball, because we were a passing team. And they like to see that kind of action. They like to see the ball being thrown, put in the air, the gambling chances, you know. Don Matthew lives on the edge, and Tracy Hamm, under his leadership, has done a great job.
In only their first year, the legends have given way to new heroes. Running back Mike Pringle has seized a place in Canadian football history. Willie Burton's CFL milestone changing hands in Baltimore.
Who would ever expect that we would be our first season, inaugural season, to win 12 games in the regular season, go through, win the Eastern Division Championship, to be here in the Grey Cup. And I think, but when you get to this point, you're here to win the football game. I've been to a national championship where we've won. I've been to a Super Bowl where we've won. I've been to a Super Bowl when we lost. And my opinion was, the time I lost the Super Bowl, I would have rather not even shown up and gone.
The Eastern Division title goes outside of Canada for the first time since 1912. CFL history built on the Colt Foundation.
So Baltimore will make a major financial profit this season. On tomorrow's Countdown show, we'll talk with Jim Spiros, who owns the Baltimore No Names. We'll talk with Bill Comrie from Edmonton, live with Commissioner Larry Smith. Speaking of Smith, one of the hot rumors here this week has been that Smith would be gone after this Grey Cup. Here's how Larry Smith answered that.
I'd like to stay on for the next 2 years of my contract. I do have my kids going to school, so I have to pay a few bills.
On a roll with the hometown advantage, Winnipeg's William Orne steps forward in his bid for bowling success in week three of Championship 5-Pin next Saturday.
This is the sprint drill underway on the floor of BC Play Stadium as Football Fest 94, the family day, continues. They had the high school football championships in this building last night. You can take the players out of the game and make them feel relatively at home in the broadcast booth, but I'll tell you what, folks, give them a chance to get back in the dressing room. They'll jump at it. Let's follow James Curry and Dan Kepley as they go back to the locker room.
James, you remember this feeling being in the locker room the day before a Grey Cup a few years ago?
Dan, it's one of those, you can just smell it, you know.
Hey, man, that's liniment and sweat, I think.
Look at the guys. Look at the way the guys are lined up, just the way we used to, huh? DBs right here, linebackers. You got the big hogs over there, the old linemen, finesse guys over here. Take a look. Isn't this just like a quarterback?
Not going very far without a football.
Hey. Gotta have the tools of your trade to pull the trigger.
What a great leader he is, huh? Leads by example.
I mean, a tougher quarterback you won't find in the CFL. This guy will find ways to play regardless of his physical condition.
James, check this out. Look at this. Can you believe that these little pads have kept Louie in this business as long as they have?
Dan, I wouldn't even risk that.
Oh, man.
You know, to walk around here and get a sense of what the players go through now. Les Brown, CFL all-time interception leader, 87 on his career, contemplating retirement after tomorrow's game.
A true pro. I mean, this is a real professional in the business. Talking about retirement, come over here, you look at 58, Robbie Smith.
All the things that get done in the game are predicated on the big hogs up front. Rob Smith has had a long, illustrious career, wants to go out on top with a Grey Cup victory.
Hey, all these leaders are like Pied Pipers, man. They got a lot of young guys in this locker room here. They're going to follow them. They're going to lead by example. And I think these kids got a lot of enthusiasm.
Well, they have enough experienced players to give them an example. But you got to go across the hall, and we look over there, Baltimore, the horse with no name over there. They came into the CFL in their inaugural season, did more things than anyone ever expected of them, and make it to a Grey Cup.
Exactly. And they started off right at the right place that they needed to go. A quarterback, a leader, Tracy Hamm.
I mean, this guy has come in. He had a great, illustrious career prior to going to Baltimore. He's taken his team under his wings, done all the things possible that you could ask of him. Now you have him on the verge of their first championship.
Well, they had the great leadership on one side of the ball, and they went out and they got it on the other side of the ball.
Gerald Bayless has done all the things. Last year, CFL MVP on the defensive side of the ball. I mean, he was the leader that they wanted, but the defense really came together when they went out and got Alfred Payton.
Well, these are a lot of kids on that team that wouldn't even know who Alfred Payton was, probably, but all of a sudden he just led the CFL in sacks the year before, comes in. He's a guy that demands respect.
Well, he showed that he's a proven leader and a bona fide player, but, you know, you think about tomorrow. You think you got enough in you for one more game?
James, I don't know, but I think I could be really scary for about two plays.
Well, here's your opportunity.
What a chance that'd be. I think I'd give up everything just for an opportunity.
I know how you feel.
And back now with our game day analysts, Ron Lancaster and Matt Dunigan, who've seen their share of sweltering locker rooms with that very specific aroma, but I guess that's a whole other show. Ron, James and Dan mentioned players like Gerald Bayless and Les Brown. You were in this game a year ago, and I know that you feel that being a leader in the room is a very particular thing. Not everybody can do it. Did you have anybody who stood up moments before the game and said the right things?
No, not really. They were very businesslike. They were looking forward to playing. That's the big thing. I think the leadership takes place off the field. You have leaders on the field. You have leaders in the locker room. Not necessarily the same people, and you don't want it that way. Some guys can try all their life to be a leader and not be one, and some guys are drawn into it. And it's great when you get the guys that can do it on and in the locker room. Doesn't always work that way, but you have to have the veteran leadership, and that's the key to any football team.
Matt, there's something very unique about the leaders on these two teams, the teams in this Grey Cup game. I think the point is that you can talk the talk all you want, but you got to be able to walk the walk.
Exactly, and a point that I like to bring across. I was talking to Adam Reed, and he brings something to mind that is so important. He's talking about his football team. On his football team, his best players weren't his leaders. But with this with these two clubs, their best players are their best leaders. And I think that's why they're here in the Cup.
Well equipped to lead in this game tomorrow. And you two, of course, have done your share of leading throughout your days in the CFL. So, Brian, back to you.
All right, Scott, as we continue live here in Vancouver, a fellow without the baseball bat, he's got football cleats and he is wearing socks here this afternoon. Paul Beeston, president of the Toronto Argonauts, joins me. Beeston is here from Toronto. We'll talk about some CFL issues in just a minute. Also here, the Stampeders are not here, but I'll tell you, those great Calgary fans are here and here in force.
No. No good.
Afternoon on the lower mainland here in southwestern British Columbia, back into the BC Place Stadium Football Fest. The family day continues. Those BC Lions cheerleaders, maybe if Austin and McManus are really hurt, we found the answer for tomorrow. Joining me is a Canadian that has succeeded in not only an American game, he's considered the best, but in the American game. Paul Beeston, he's known to many Canadians as the president of the Toronto Blue Jays. You're also president of the Toronto Argonauts. Who better to talk about Canadian quotas? Now, I know yourself, Gordy Craig, TSN, have only been involved for a year, but what is your view to the elimination of Canadians?
Well, I think it's inevitable, unfortunately. I happen to be a nationalist. I would like to see the Canadians stay in the game. I mean, I've watched this game forever. I mean, I watched it when I was growing up in Hamilton. I watched the people in Welland going to Hamilton. I watched people come into the community and stay in the community. I watched guys like Ronnie Lancaster, who's here today, who's come up here, who's become Canadian. For all practical purposes, that is a great thing. However, having said that, the game has expanded. It's gone in the United States. And they have got all Americans there, which, I mean, I think we can expect. And you have to look at it from a different perspective.
All right, let's be realistic. There is no one more pro-Canadian than Ron Lancaster. Lancaster was saying, what about the fact, the other side of the coin, people in Regina, Edmonton, Toronto would rather see a winning team than a team of Canadians. Do you agree with that?
I think they would rather see a winning team. I think that probably Ronnie's got that right. From my perspective, though, when you're trying to put a product on the field, and as the game is expanding, and we now have a new franchise, United States, in Memphis, we have a team in Baltimore, a team that really, I think we can go with the Canadian content, with the Argos, man for man, with when we're playing without having to get in the extra guys. But when they have to replace guys, Brian, there's just a lot more people they can choose from.
Yeah, it is the depth. Very quickly, what do you say to somebody out in Halifax that's a university football player and says, I have no future now?
I don't think that's true. I think there will be a future. I mean, we have to look at it. I don't know where we're going to go with this. I do know that the CFL has to work with the Players Association. They have to be sensitive to our history. I mean, we've got a league that has been around for 100 years. We have to be sensitive to that. And we have to say it was a Canadian Canadian League. So what is the answer? I don't know. Is it a quota of 5? Is it a quota of 10? Is it a quota of 6? Is it a quota of 20? But I think we have to examine it, and we have to be responsible because we do have a history as a league.
There's excitement here in BC. It's overshadowing the issues. Another issue, there are 3 pro football teams, including yours in Ontario. Your university, Western, and the University of Saskatchewan, had the biggest football crowd in the province. What is wrong with football in Ontario, and can you revive it?
Well, I think, yes, it can be revived, number one. Number two is, I think it's just a matter of we haven't provided good entertainment lately. And we had a team that won 3 games in 1993. Hamilton has been, you know, under 500. Ottawa has been under 500. We've got to put competitive teams out there. I think we have to look at the market that we're in, and I think that we can do it. It's great entertainment. I mean, we have had some of the best games that I have seen. Don't smile. We have had some great games. We've had some great games in Toronto this year, and it will go.
Let me ask you this. What about rumors, and I hear them everywhere out here, that Labatt's, Beeston and company are going to buy the Tampa Bay Buccaneers of the NFL and move them to Toronto?
Well, I know nothing about that if that's in fact true. We run the Toronto Argonauts. I'm the president of the Toronto Argonauts. Bob Nicholson runs the Toronto Argonauts. Bob Wavilovich is the coach and general manager of the Toronto Argonauts. Our goal is to do as good a job as we can, put that team on the field to win a Grey Cup. That's our mandate. I know nothing about the other, and I say that honestly. I would never lie to you.
All right. It was a couple of years ago on this very show, a fellow we both know, Wayne Gretzky, sat here. I think he was angry at me because I was anti-expansion. I've never been sold on expansion. And he said to me about Toronto, he said, Brian, if Bruce McNall, John Candy, and myself can't make football go in Toronto, no one can. What do you say to that?
I say I think we've got a shot at doing it. I think we turn it around this year. Bob Nicholson has put together a group, a marketing group, that kind of flattened out this year, and then as we started going through the year, kind of picked up. And there was excitement there. There were some great games at the end. There was some fun. People were talking about the games. People were talking about the CFL. People were talking about the Argonauts. I see this thing turn around. We have to give it 1 year of honest effort where we are running this thing in a professional basis. The Toronto Blue Jays were not an instant success. The Toronto Blue Jays in 1981 would not have drawn 1 million people but for the strike. And now everyone says, you know, it's a great franchise. It takes time. You don't turn around. You don't turn a ship around in a dime. You don't turn this team around in a dime.
Now, listen, you mentioned the Blue Jays. You won't talk to me about the NFL. Tell me, are you going to impose a salary cap on the players next week?
We're
going to
have a meeting on December the 5th, and at that time there will be some, I'm sure, very lively discussion.
Are you glad you got involved in the Canadian Football League?
Absolutely. It's been fun. I mean, it's you know what has most impressed me about it are the quality of people in the game, from the players, the coaches, and the owners. I mean, this is a great group of great guys, and you know they're committed to it. And if we can get the crowds back, I think that we've got the product that's going to make people want to come out.
And listen, Baltimore has excited the whole league. They're talking about this game.
There's no question. And you know, I've got a lot of friends down there, and I have never ever worn my World Series ring. But I'm wearing it today because just in the unlikely event the Baltimore wins, I want my friends in Baltimore to know that we have the World Series in Canada.
All right, here's the World Series ring. Paul Beeston, thank you very much. I'm going to put that in my pocket. Stay with us. We appreciate you joining us. We'll salute the player awards as we go to commercial on this Saturday afternoon from here in Vancouver. I have to do it back. I tell you what, folks, there is absolutely, I mean, look at this. Hold that shot for a minute. There is no more beautiful setting anywhere in North America. There's the outside of the dome. Let's switch, and we come inside as the Football Fest 94 Family Day continues. With the expansion to 12 teams, the officiating crews have grown by 50%. However, there has been tremendous criticism of CFL officials in 1994.
Cliff, what the hell are you talking about? Who the hell threw that flag? Bull crap! Who the hell threw that flag?
Now, I think it might be better if Cal had an opinion. There's no question the officials are on the firing line. It's been a real blaze, though, this season. Their job, a series of split-second decisions. The calls that make the difference between a win or even this one, a team's playoff hopes. The Sacramento Gold Miners thought they had a touchdown and a chance to grab fourth place. The official thinking otherwise, a bundle of appeals and criticism have flooded the league office. In a perfectly called game, the officials will go unnoticed. They just make the tough call, get it right, no thanks, no recognition. It is simply play on, man.
push just a little bit, not much, but just enough.
Now you'll see this man from time to time tomorrow afternoon. He's got the toughest job of all, and he is proud of it.
Baltimore will decline and force BC.
Procedure, BC number 82, decline, third down.
Here he is, head referee for tomorrow's game, Jake Townsend from Jake Ireland from Townsend, Ontario. Where in the heck is Townsend, Ontario?
Townsend is about 40 miles southwest of Hamilton on Lake Erie, or close to Lake Erie.
Down near Port Dover. All right, how do you relate, Jake Ireland, to the criticism this year? There's been more than in previous seasons.
Well, certainly with expansion and the addition of 15 new officials this year, there have been a few situations, which you would expect. But criticism is part of the job. If you can't withstand the criticism, it's not the business to be in.
Is it in your opinion that the officiating is as good now as it was 5 or 6 years ago?
My honest opinion is the officiating in the league has improved steadily in the 16 years that I've been here.
What do you do to get ready for this game? I mean, you don't do this full time. You're out here full time this week. We'll talk about your personal life in just a minute, but what do you do out here this week?
This week? Well, we came in Friday, and we'll have a series of meetings on Friday and Saturday and again Sunday morning, reviewing films to look at team tendencies and that sort of thing.
Now, James Curry's on our broadcast crew. Do you look for fellas like James Curry when you review the films?
We are not looking for individuals per se. We're looking for more like the formations the teams have, where their receivers tend to go, where the points of action are most likely to be.
Now, this is not a full-time job for you or your cohorts. What do you do when you're not doing football?
I'm a customer service manager for Stelco, Inc. That's a Lake Erie Works steel plant.
Now, how do you prepare for a season? Do you have like a three-week seminar before the season? Do they take you to a training camp like the players?
Actually, we have a short training camp of about 3 days. We come in and we go through physical fitness testing, medicals, rules exams, positioning and mechanics exams, and then we review the basics of the game.
Baltimore and Vancouver, what do you see as your biggest challenge here tomorrow?
I don't know. The biggest challenge could be the noise, but as far as the teams go, there's no single big thing. This is the big one for everything, but they could try anything at any time.
Well, we hope we don't see you tomorrow, and you're conspicuous by your absence. We got to go down to the field. Can you quickly mention your cohorts that are working the game tomorrow?
Okay, and the easiest way, I think, would be geographic. From the Toronto area, we've got Don Ellis, the back judge, and Bill Hagens, the head linesman. From the Winnipeg area, we have Ken Lazarick, who's a standby referee, Glenn Johnson, who is a standby official, and Art McAvoy, who is the side judge. From Regina, we have Ken Pickett, who's the umpire. And from the Edmonton area, we have Woody Bredeman, the line judge, and Bernie Prusco, the field judge.
All right, good luck to you and the crew tomorrow afternoon, Jake Ireland. And again, I hope you're conspicuous by your absence. Let's go down to Scott Oak on the floor. Scott?
All right, Brian, well, I'm with two men who know how tough an official's life is, Ron Lancaster and Matt Dunigan. Let's face it, guys, the poor guy is half wrong before he starts, depending on who he throws the flag on. Ron, do you think that Tracy Hamm tomorrow may have to solicit Jake Ireland's help to deal with the noise in here, and would that be wise?
I'd give Tracy this advice. Number one, just go out and play the game. If you allow the crowd to get involved and you worry about it, you're looking and giving yourself a reason to lose. Get it out of your mind, man. It's going to be noisy. It's going to be fun. Just go play football. The minute you walk away from the center, you're in trouble the rest of the day. Play the game, enjoy the crowd, have fun with it. That's what this game's all about.
How would you describe it, Matt? Maybe like throwing gas on the fire?
Exactly. Once the fans see you back away once, you're just asking them to get louder.
Let me ask you this. Ron and I watched both final games last weekend. They were good games. There were, as is always the case in football, calls by the officials you might want to second guess. But the reality is the games were decided by the players, did not come down to a controversial call. That's what we hope for tomorrow.
Without question. You're looking at, was it a fumble? Was it not a fumble? Was it a goalpost? Did the win have a factor? Yeah, they all had factors. But when it comes down to it, we had five plays that we did not execute that could have made a difference offensively. So it's not the officiating, it's the players ultimately in every game that's decided who wins and loses.
Scott, a long time ago, Vince Lombardi said football game will come down to five plays. The reason you hustle on all the plays is you don't know which five is going to determine the outcome of the game. Matt just stated it again, and it will hold true again tomorrow.
And how gracious of Matt Dunigan to get the officials off the hook with respect to your loss in the East final last week, and that's why you're working with us this weekend.
Well, exactly. I mean, it's not the coaches, it's not the schemes, it's not the referees, it's the players that decide the game. I fumbled a snap inside the goal line. You know, I could have called a better game. You have to look within as players. It's not the coaches, it's not the officials.
Lots of great stories coming up in this game tomorrow. The American-Canadian battle, Darren Flutie, 60,000 fans in here perhaps. But beyond all that, Brian, we're looking for a great game because when all is said and done, it's the game that matters the most. Back to you.
All right, Scott, can we keep open Matt Dunigan's microphone down there? Hey, Matt, with that ponytail, would I take it maybe you're pulling for the Baltimore Ponies?
Oh, hey, yeah, no, it's a good one, Brian. I've seen you in makeup, pal. Don't get me started.
All right. Matt Dunigan and Ron Lancaster, they'll be game day guests with Scott Oake tomorrow afternoon. Stay with us. Live coverage to Grey Cup Weekend 94. Of course, with my hair, I shouldn't be talking. Live coverage to Grey Cup 94 will continue from Vancouver after this. Talk about unforgettable. Angelo Mosca was in the hotel lobby the other night. He was looking for Willie Fleming. You know what's interesting? Of the eight Canadian teams in the CFL, I found this very interesting. Only one has never won a Grey Cup in this city, and you guessed it. That team is the British Columbia Lions. Now in 1994 for the BC Lions, it's a third try at becoming the hometown heroes.
Ago, and Beatlemania was about to strike.
I have a dream.
In the United States, the Americans had a dream that turned into a Dallas nightmare. In Canada, we welcomed a new prime minister. In Vancouver, dreams of a Grey Cup were very much alive at Empire Stadium. The BC Lions were led by Willie Fleming and their cagey quarterback, number 22, Joe Capp. They were in tough against Hamilton's Ralph Sazio and John Barrow. This was the first appearance in the Cup for the team that roared to life in 1954. Many a championship game has been won or lost on one play. A harmless pitch to Fleming, a hit from Angelo Mosca, and the Lions' ace leaves the game with a concussion. And with his departure goes BC's shot at the Cup.
1963, we had the best team. I know that much. And a couple injuries, I got injured. A couple other guys got injured, but our guys tried. And it was a tough loss for us. That's the type of game you don't cry about too much, but I think quite a few of us cried that day when we lost that one. And we thought we had the best team that year in Canada.
CFL bragging rights for 63 belong to the Hamilton Tiger Cats. In 83, it rose like a giant mushroom, the Lions' new home. BC Place would welcome a Pope and earn a reputation for fearsome noise. For the second time in franchise history, the Lions try to win the Cup at home, led by Al Wilson, Swerve and Murr, and a new head coach, Don Matthews. With Roy DeWalt throwing strikes, it looked good for the Leos against the Argonauts. But in the end, it was Toronto that ended a long cup drought. And once again, BC fans were denied the thrill of a cup win at home.
You know, that was a very exciting time. It was my first year as a head football coach, and the BC Lions hadn't been in the Grey Cup in 19 years, and our football players turned it around. It was a great finish at the end of the season, and then a one-point loss to the Toronto Argos. It was very disappointing, but also it was very satisfying at the same time, because our football team then turned it around and was on a pretty darn good run for the rest of the couple of years.
Doesn't get better than this. McManus, end zone, touchdown Lions! BC's going to the Grey Cup!
7 days ago, last second Lion heroics against Calgary.
Good break, 2 years in a row at McMahon Stadium.
The 94 season began with the late signing of Kent Austin. The Lions had an offense, but head coach Dave Ritchie was counting heads on defense. The defense responded brilliantly, and so did Corey Philpott. The Lions had a running game and were dancing at 7-1. The roller coaster ride took a downward turn, the result of too many penalties, but turned up again in the playoffs. He was there in 83 and remembers the loss. Another chance to win a cup at home for the Lions veteran place kicker.
For me, the season won't be complete, but also the last 9 years since we won one would be all for naught, so to speak, because you play those games, those years to be in this one game, and you don't get too many shots at it. I've played 19 years. This is only my fourth time at it, and I don't want to leave anything behind. I want to do whatever I can and leave it all in the field on Sunday.
And from one great Canadian, Lou Pasaglia with the Lions, here is a Canadian center, Big Al Wilson. He was on that 1983 team. He retired in 86 that was beaten by the Toronto Argonauts in this building. As we wind things down on this Saturday afternoon from here on the West Coast, still a fair amount to come on the show. And very quickly, let's go down to Steve Armitage. Steve?
Thank you very much, Brian. The biggest guessing game all week long here at BC Place Stadium has concerned the starting quarterback assignment. If you're head coach Dave Ritchie, who do you go with, Kent Austin or Danny McManus? You'll remember Kent Austin, of course, was absolutely brilliant in the first half against the Calgary Stampeders, but he re-injured his left shoulder. He spent a lot of time in the Vancouver Canucks hyperbaric oxygen chamber and has looked very sharp in practices throughout the week. Danny McManus came on in relief of Austin last week against the Calgary Stampeders and was absolutely brilliant in engineering that final drive. So that's the tough decision that the head coach has to make. Do you go with the marquee player, Kent Austin, or do you go with the super sub, the man who backs up so brilliantly, Danny McManus? I think, and I know Dave Ritchie, I think he'll go with Kent Austin, his marquee quarterback, as the starter for the BC Lions in the Grey Cup game tomorrow. Now, with his final thoughts on the Can-Am matchup here tomorrow, let's join Mark Lee. Mark?
Well, Steve, five Canadian offensive linemen will be blocking for those battered American quarterbacks in what will be an historic football game, the first time an American team plays in the Grey Cup game. BC will feature 20 Canadians tomorrow. Baltimore has none. Is that an unfair advantage? On the eve of this big game, we put that question to an American-born and an American-trained football player, linebacker Alfred Payton.
There's a slight advantage for us depth-wise. We have more talent with all, you know, more Americans, and it's been showing, especially with the speed, overall team speed, and like the front, like with the offensive linemen, you know, they're Canadians, and can't say with all the teams, but you know, we've been able to dominate our front four against those Canadian offensive line.
We'll watch that matchup tomorrow and what becomes a litmus test of sorts for Canadian players amid concerns that the quota will be cut in half during the offseason from 20 to 10 per team. And I'm sure a lot of the young Canadian fans, Brian, here are joined here on the floor of BC Play Stadium will be interested to see how they fare tomorrow. Back to you.
Mark, to carry that thought a little further, if you're just joining us, Paul Beeston, president of the Toronto Argonauts, told me here a short time ago he thought Canadian quotas would be a thing of the past within the very near future. Speaking of history, Don Wittman has called more Grey Cups than any broadcaster in history. Up next, we'll talk with Don Wittman as we continue live from Vancouver.
They've been a winning combo.
Ships at anchor in English Bay as they wait to come into the harbor. There's the False Creek area. Partly cloudy afternoon and one of the world's truly most beautiful cities. Mountaintops are covered. They had snow partway down the mountains the other day, but a warm Saturday afternoon as we come inside BC Play Stadium and wrap up our show on this Saturday afternoon. Don Wittman, your 33rd Grey Cup.
It's been a long time.
We talk so much about noise. Your thoughts on noise? I mean, you've seen them noisy, you've seen them quiet, you've seen them wet, you've seen them dry.
I'd much rather have the noisy games because that means the place is sold out, and that will be the case tomorrow. Brian, there's a delicious touch of irony to the noise problem that we have heard so much about this week. In 83, 84, and particularly in 85, when Don Matthews was the coach of the BC Lions and they were facing the Winnipeg Blue Bombers in those Western Finals, I think it was 85 when the noise really became a major problem. And Cal Murphy and the Blue Bombers had to go for special earplugs, and they had customized earplugs from a firm here in Coquitlam. This past week, Don Matthews phoned Cal Murphy and said, where did you get those earplugs you used back in 1985? And several members of the Baltimore CFLers were experimenting with those earplugs yesterday and again today at practice.
Don, we've talked about Canadian quotas. We've seen some great Canadian players this afternoon. You were talking about Louis Pisaglia during the commercial.
You know, there are just so many stories about Lou Pisaglia. I spent some time with Lou. He has a ritual, a game day ritual, that he won't be able to perform tomorrow. He goes to a movie every day before the BC Lions play at home in the evening. Well, Sunday, there isn't going to be a movie available to him at 10 o'clock in the morning unless he dials one up on his hotel television screen. But Louis, in his very first year, his first scoring points in the CFL were a touchdown. John Shara threw him a 12-yard out. It was late in the game against the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and Cal Murphy was then the coach, said, Lou, you may as well go out there and run an out pattern. He ran it in the end zone, took a 12-yard pass for a touchdown. He remembers that vividly, all the details. I said, Lou, what about your first field goal? He said, you know, I don't even remember who I kicked it against or when.
Listen, you remember your first game. We got to go.
1961, the only overtime game in Grey Cup history. Kenny Plain, 18-yard touchdown run. I remember it vividly.
We'd have a great, great show tomorrow. You'll be joined in the booth by Dan Kepley. Thank you, and James Curry. Scott Oak will host the game coverage tomorrow as we say goodbye from British Columbia on this Saturday afternoon. Let's show you the menu, if you will, for tomorrow. We're on the air at 2 Pacific with our Grey Cup countdown show. That's 5 Eastern. Larry Smith will ask him the questions about the Canadian quota, about the troubles that football is having in Ontario. We'll talk with Jim Spiros, who is the owner of the Baltimore No Names, Bill Comrie from Edmonton, and don't forget game coverage 1 hour later at 6 Eastern, 3 Pacific. Well, we certainly hope you've enjoyed our show here this afternoon from BC Play Stadium in Vancouver. The King, Elvis Presley, is rocking in the background as the Football Fest 94, the family day, continues here on the floor of BC Play Stadium. For all of us, Don Wittman, Scott Oak, Mark Lee, our analysts, production and technical people, we'll see you tomorrow afternoon at 5 Eastern, 2 Pacific. I'm Brian Williams. So long from Vancouver.